And welcome to worship. A word before we begin. In the wake of all that is happening, today we are called in worship to address the reality of war. We're going to do that both from the perspective of our faith and as Americans. I want to say to you, beloved, that this may not be the easiest service that we've ever had together. Because it is hard and heartbreaking. I want you to know that, as always, it is okay to cry. Tears of sorrow, tears of faith. Remember during the service to breathe. As God's people, remember also that we are not called to turn away from that which is challenging or hard, but that we are called to turn to it as God's servants and people. This is true today as we speak about the horror of war. So please take a deep breath now as you get prepared to see the cover of the bulletin. And let us now look at our centering thought. The centering thought is from Roman Catholic sister Joan Chisseter, one of the great prophets regarding not responding to people with vengeance. "Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. Save us from our desire to hurt as we have been hurt, to punish as we have been punished, to terrorize as we have been terrorized."
I'm going to lay down my burden, down by the riverside, down by that river, down by that riverside. Gonna lay down my burden down by that riverside. Study war no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Study war no more. Study war no more, no more. I ain't gonna study war no more. Study war no more. Study war no more. Lay down my sword and shield.
Down by the riverside.
Down by the riverside.
Down by the riverside.
I'm gonna lay down my sword and shield.
Down by the riverside.
Study war no more.
let us join together in our call to worship and prayer of the day. Let us pray. God, we want to make right the wrongs of our nation's immoral wars. We repent for our thinking, our believing, our insisting that bombs and missiles and drones and tanks could ever bring peace. We are on our knees and pray for your forgiveness. We hope more of our American Christian siblings will join us on our knees. And we pray today that we all leave the political scapegoating behind and to do whatever we can to help our desperate sisters and brothers in Afghanistan. Oh God, we've got a lot of work to do. Help us. Amen. And now, my friends, may the peace of Christ be with you and also with you. Let us share in the peace of Christ. Let us hear this special music now before our sermon.
Young girls have picked them, everyone. the young girls go? Long time passing, where have all the young, where have all the young girls gone? Long time ago. Long time ago. Nice. Where have all the young girls gone? To young men, everyone. Gone to young men, everyone. Oh, when will they ever learn? Oh, when will they ever learn?
Where have all the young men gone? Where have all the young men gone? Long time past, where have they gone? Where have all the young men gone? Soldiers, gone for soldiers, everyone. Oh, when will they ever learn? Oh, when will they ever learn?
Where have all the soldiers gone? Long time passing. Where have all the soldiers gone?
As I begin now, I'm thinking of the remarkable reality, remarkable in its sorrow and hopelessness and seeming intractability, the reality that is playing itself out, stemming from the 20-year post-9/11 wars. In the face of all of that, when a preacher rises and seeks to apply the word of God to a world that is out of control, the question legitimately and importantly comes, why? Why speak into the abyss of darkness and death? How can it make a difference? You're just wasting your breath, preacher. What good does it do? I mean, here we sit. Looks like we have, if you count the windows that have more than one people, I guess we have about 60 of us here today. Why does the preacher take up a topic such as this? Do you remember the scene of Jesus's entry into Jerusalem? We call it Palm Sunday. You remember he's riding on a donkey. He enters the city and his followers are proclaiming the most preposterous things. They are saying, God's kingdom is coming. Justice is coming. The poor will be lifted up. The hungry will be fed. The wars will end. And the merchants of greed who are there, the merchants of power, the folks who are in charge, the folks who likes the way things are, the status quo, they heard all of this coming from Jesus's followers, and they tell Jesus, tell your people to be quiet. Wars are necessary. Trickle-down economics works. We don't need a new kingdom. The way things are now are just fine. Thank you very much. Tell them to shut up, Jesus. Jesus replies, I tell you, if these my people were quiet, the very rocks would cry out. Jesus knew that God's truth is so pervasive, it is just everywhere, it's knitted into the fabric of our universe. Even the rocks know it. The whole universe is pregnant with love, a love that cannot be stopped. So, that is why a preacher in a small church dares to proclaim God's enormous truth. And not only that, but dares to believe this truth will indeed come to pass. For our words here that we speak are grounded in God's truth, and it joins with all of creation, friends, to be part of a force for love and peace that even the rocks know will come to pass. Our country is reeling. So many gargantuan challenges, the virus, the aftermath of the hurricane, and the assault on our planet by oil and coal that scientists tell us grew the monster that was Ida. The relentless depravity of racism that ferociously attacks the very fabric of our country. There's more than that, and astonishingly, something so large and so awful that it might just overshadow all of the other things that I just said, and that is war and the consequences of war. So the preacher listens as best as he can and is called to speak what I have heard in God's word about war. Let us pray. Let us be brave enough, O God, to not only encounter your word, but open ourselves to it and help the poor preacher speak the truth. Amen. There have been in times in human history and many times when it was believed that war was necessary. It seems we all continue to live under this belief, but there are those who challenge it. Indeed, when we listen to those who have gone before us, who have fought in wars and lived to speak about it, we very frequently hear another message. We hear a hope, an imperative that burns deep within veterans who have been in conflict. They urge us and beg us and demand of us that war should never be a first option, a first response to conflict. In the face of all that has happened, over 20 years in the wars after 9/11. And as we as a people try and reckon with the consequences of our war, today I want us to hear from three veterans who did not die in a war, but lived to speak for those who did die. All three of these veterans served in World War II. All three of them are gone now. But their words can still reach us and change us if we listen. First, let us hear God's word from Scripture. In days to come, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established as the highest of the mountains and shall be raised above the hills, and all the nations shall stream to it. Many people shall come and they will say, come, let us go to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of God of Jacob, that he may teach us her ways and that we may walk in her paths. For out of Zion shall go forth instruction and the word of the Lord. God shall judge between the nations and shall arbitrate for many peoples. And they shall beat their swords into farming equipment and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up sword against nation, and they will learn war no more. My father was a patriotic American. When it was time, he signed up to fight in World War II. He was a proud veteran. His job was an officer in charge of a radar station on the top of the tallest mountain in northern Italy. He and his men were responsible to guide U.S. bombers over the mountains, first heavy with bombs, and then returning later empty, but wounded and crippled from anti-aircraft fire. He, for 33 months, my father was in constant peril, both because his work was so strategic to the prosecution of the war and because they were so vulnerable there on top of that mountain. Dad told me harrowing stories about his experiences there. But the most vivid memory I have wasn't a story at all. It was a lecture he gave me and my brother. As a boy, I had an Army toy soldier set. The soldiers were about 3 inches high. They were hard rubber. Maybe you remember some of these. They dark army green, little platforms under their feet so you could stand them and they would stand up. Till with our guns and cannons and bayonets, they were shot and killed in our game. My brother and I played war. We learned war. We studied war in some sense. My dad one day saw this. My dad, who had a deep faith in Almighty God, who, like all men raised then, were taught real men don't cry. And he never used profanity. He watched our war game, saw our innocence, our vulnerability, our deep and profound misunderstanding of what war is. One day, when in my boyish eagerness, I tried to get him to tell me some exciting, daring do story from the war, he spoke to me in a way that cleared out the cobwebs in my little brain of my childhood infatuation with war, and he burned into my neural pathways of my brain in such a way that I still remember it, even today, what he said and the tone of voice with which he said it. He said, son, war is the worst thing there is. It is not God's will. God did not make us to kill each other. War is hell, son. It's damn hell. And then to my astonishment, his eyes filled with tears. And he said, I was given a gun and I was trained to use it. But I do not believe I could have ever killed another person. Thank you, Dad. I honor you. I thank you for your courage. And I hear now, even from heaven where you are, your warning. It was my privilege and joy to be Captain John Waters' pastor in the late 1980s and early 90s. John Waters was in the Navy in World War II and later changed over to the Coast Guard, where he became a captain. John became quite famous in the Coast Guard, authoring a book and a manual on search and rescue at sea. It is still used to this very day. It is a classic. John was a tall man with a barrel chest and a big ruddy face and a voice to go with that presence. We both had our sailboats at the same marina on the St. John's River in Jacksonville, Florida. And when John said good morning to someone on A dock, people on F dock responded, good morning. My son Jeremy was then 5 or 6, and he loved Captain Waters. Captain Waters taught Jeremy when he approached for Jeremy to snap to attention and to wait for Captain John to salute. And when he did, Jeremy would return the salute, but he would not break his attention until John bellowed, carry on. John said, carry on, in such a way that those who were on the dock and not doing anything suddenly looked around for something to do. World War II or the Korean War, he served in them both. Neither of them killed him. It was cancer. I officiated at the funeral. And no one who was at the funeral that day will ever forget a little 6-year-old blonde-headed kid marching down the center of the aisle of that big church to the coffin before the service began, snapping to attention and saluting. And I am not the only one who was there that day who swears that they heard, carry on. One afternoon before he got sick, John and I were below deck in his 38-foot sloop, and we got to talking about the war. John had been on a support group boat for the invasion of Omaha Beach. He was there and saw what happened at Omaha Beach. If you have seen the movie Saving Private Ryan, you know something of what the horrish hell that was. And then there came another time in my life, beloved, when a man who is not inclined to cry, a Navy officer, a captain in the Coast Guard, had tears streamed down his cheeks. And he said in a steady voice, if every damn politician who ever rushed other people's children to war could have been at Omaha Beach, we wouldn't have any more war. And I say with deep affection, I remember you, Captain Waters, and I thank you for your courage. And I hear your warning. Like the first two, the third veteran we hear from this morning was no starry-eyed idealist. 5-star general in the U.S. Army, Dwight David Eisenhower, was the commander of all Allied forces in the European theater of World War II. He knew firsthand the depth of evil in Nazi Germany. Yet, he never turned from or lost sight of a greater danger, that of relying on the military as the solution to the problems of the world. In 1953, General Eisenhower was a Republican candidate for president, and he said these words: "Every gun that is made, every warship that is launched, every rocket that is fired signifies, in the final sense, a theft from those who are hungry and not fed, those who are cold and not clothed. This world in arms is not spending money alone," he said. "It is spending the sweat of its laborers, the genius of its scientists, the hopes of its children." His passion for peace, for ending war, remained throughout his presidency. And in his famous farewell speech to the nation, while acknowledging the dangerous world we live in, he nevertheless issued this prophetic warrior's warning: "In the councils of government, we must guard against the acquisition of unwanted influence by the military-industrial complex. The potential for the disastrous rise of misplaced power exists and will persist. We must never let the weight of this endanger our liberties or democracy. Only an alert and knowledgeable citizenry can compel the proper meshing of the huge industrial military complex with our peaceful methods and goals." Yesterday was the 20th anniversary of the horrific day of September 11th, 2001. Your pastor deeply questions now, as I did at the time, in word and in civil disobedience, the decision of George W. Bush to enter into this 20-year war. For if the purpose of the attack at 9/11, if the purpose of that was to weaken our country, what has our response done over the last 20 years? Are we stronger or weaker because of our response? The deaths: 2,448 service members, 3,846 U.S. contractors, not to mention 67,000 Afghan allies. Only part of the story. 300,000 with post-traumatic stress disorder, wounds and trauma that have caused an epidemic of suicide. Listen, please listen. 4 times more soldiers have died of suicide than died in combat in the wars after 9/11. 4 times. 30,177 suicides. 15 times the number of people who died on 9/11. Are we better off? Nobel Prize-winning economist Joseph Stiglitz, in a book a few years after the war, start of the war, determined the cost to be of the war, to prosecute it, $720 million a day. What could have been done with that money for the children of our country? Are we better off, friends? Another estimate put it this way. The war in Afghanistan and Iraq was costing per soldier $2 million per soldier. That same year, UNICEF, the worldwide organization that tries to help the poor, calculated that the cost of adding iodized salt to the diet of an Afghan infant, a step which would have prevented brain damage to them and those children suffering from malnourishment, would be 5 cents per child per year. Is the world better off? I close with this. About 7 years into the post 9/11 wars, Michael Moore, the filmmaker, produced a documentary on the health crisis. A 4-year-old girl whose mother rushed her to the hospital had an extremely high temperature because of a tooth infection. They had no insurance and were turned away. In the intervening time it took searching for a hospital, she got sicker and died. 4.3 million children today have no health insurance in the United States of America. Today, tomorrow, on Monday, $2 billion in one day goes to the military budget. Are we better off? What was it General Eisenhower said? The acquisition of unwarranted influence, the disastrous rise of misplaced power. I wonder, do you wonder what General Eisenhower would say about those children? Even more about that, what would Jesus say? Learn war no more.
This is my home.
Beloved, we come now to a time of joys and concerns as we lift them up in our prayer time. Do any of you have any thing that you would like to share? We'll join together in our Lord's Prayer. Let us pray together. Our Father, our Mother, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And we will now offer our prayer of dedication over the gifts of money and time and talent that we give in service of God through this church. Let us pray. Generous God, you have made rich and poor, powerful and vulnerable alike in your image. Bless the gifts we have gathered today, that we may use them to protect the afflicted and bring greater justice to your world. Amen. Now, do any of you have any announcements? I would just like to say two things. There is a Compassionate Justice Council meeting after worship, and I see Steve is on here. Steve, I'm just going to, because of the nature of today's service, say that if any of you are in feeling a need to say something in response to the sermon, I think that after we get through with our going out song, we'll take 5 minutes or so. And anybody that wants to stay on and express themselves in any way about the sermon or the topic or whatever, we'll do that. And Steve, I hope that will not delay your all's meeting too much. I don't think it will. Secondly, be on the lookout as a follow-up to this sermon, a special e-blast. I'm going to send you a link to an article in the Washington Post that contains amazing information about some of the released documents about what happened prior to 9/11 and after 9/11 that all of us need to know in terms of the culpability of the sitting president at that time. That also might engender much discussion, and we can find a time to do that. But be on the lookout probably Monday or Tuesday. That I'll send you that link from the Washington Post. If there are no other announcements, then our benediction and going out song is a, how many of you have heard the name Bobby Darin? It took a minute for it to click into our brain. That was a singer from our time. He sang during one of the extremely tense times between America and Russia, a simple song of freedom. And I'm going to play that as our benediction. But I wanted to read the words because I think they're so important and pertinent, and I wanted to make sure you got them. Come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. Let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere. We the people here don't want a war. Hey there, Mr. Black Man, can you hear me? I don't want any of your money or games. I do want to be someone known to you as me. And I will bet my life you want the same. Of course, there was lots of racial tension at that time. 700 million are listening. Most of what you read is made of lies. But speaking one-to-one, ain't it everybody's son to wake to the morning when we rise? No doubt some folks enjoy going to battle, like presidents, prime ministers, and king. So let's all build them shelves so that they can fight among themselves and leave us to be those who just want to sing. Now, Brother Solzhenitsyn, are you busy? If not, won't you drop this friend a line and tell me if the man who is plowing up your land has got the war machine upon his mind? No way. Oh, and also I wanted to say, you're going to hear at the very end some serious gospel music going on. I hope you enjoy it.
Come and sing the simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. And let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere. We the people here don't want war. Hey there, Mr. Black Man, can you hear me? I don't want your diamonds or your game. I just want to be someone known to you as we. And I will bet my life you want the same. So come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. And let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere. We the people here don't want a war. 700 million, are you listening? Most of what you read is made of lies. But speaking one to one, ain't it everybody's son? Wake you in the mornings when we rise. So come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. And let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere. We the people here don't want a war. Now, Brother Solzhenitsyn, are you busy? If not, won't you drop this friend a line and tell me if the man who is plowing up your land has got the war machine upon his mind? No way. I say come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. And let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere. We the people here don't want a war. Now no doubt some folks enjoy doing battle, like presidents, prime ministers, or kings. So let's all build them shelves where they can fight it out among themselves and leave the people be who love to sing. Come and sing a simple song of freedom. Sing it like you've never sung before. And let it fill the air. Tell the people everywhere that we the here don't want a war. I say let it fill the air. Tell them people everywhere. We the people here don't want a war. Freedom. I say freedom. I say freedom. I mean freedom.
Now that brought back some memories, eh? Bobby Darin. So would anybody like to chat about that? Or just about anything, too. Don't you forget, you got to pretend like you got some of Joyce's coffee in your hand, sitting around the table.